Hi, this is Graham from Jenham's Astro. A while ago I reviewed a 60mm Prince refractor that I bought online from an auction website, and that scope dated probably to the 1980s, and I guess I got the bug for looking at older refractors, and I started looking around for a larger aperture scope, and I came across a 3-inch achromatic refractor on a website, and it's for sale with all of its accessories, its equatorial mount, and its original case. So I bought the scope for £100 and I'm hoping that it's going to turn out to be a good buy. So this particular one has got an objective of 76.2mm diameter, and it's got a focal length of 1250mm, so that gives it a focal ratio of 16.4. So when I've done a little bit of research of this sort of scope, there are relatively few with this particular focal length, and there are a lot more with the same objective but with a 1200mm focal length. Either way, that sort of refractor, you really expect to get almost no false colour. So I don't know much about where this scope came from originally, so I'm going to talk you through some of the features, and we can see what clues we get from those about its origin. So the brand on this particular scope is Astro, which couldn't really sound more generic. I've had a look into the Cloudy Nights and the Stargazers Lounge forums, where there's quite a lot of correspondence about classic refractors like this, and it's told me that this scope was marketed under different brand names in different countries. So here in the UK, this scope was the Prince 660, whereas in other countries I've seen examples where the branding was Dean Beam, OKKK, Royal Astro, Yamatar, and a few others besides. You can see on the focuser that there is a small K inside a circle. So I'm calling this a Circle K model. Originally that thought that meant the manufacturer was a company called Kenko versus Tower for the Circle T 60mm scope in my previous video. But apparently things are a little bit more complicated than that. And the scope could have been made by Tower and sold by another company called Astro Optics. Maybe it was the other way around. Unfortunately, this particular unit doesn't have a serial number, so that may make things a little bit more difficult in terms of identification. Some good news, rack and pinion focuser still works pretty well. I've applied a bit of grease, and perhaps more importantly, the focuser draw tube is large enough to allow adaptation to modern eyepieces. So you can unscrew the standard adapter, and on the end of the draw tube there is a thread inside, which is called a Vixen thread, and it's 36.4mm in diameter, and it allows you to swap the original adapter for a more modern example. So here's one from Barter Planetarium, but there are other examples which you can buy, and you simply screw that in place of the original adapter, and you're then in a good position to use 1¼-inch eyepieces. Okay, so if we start with the finder, I've read that it can be a feature that helps you distinguish between the many similar scopes. This one, the only obvious mark on it to me is the magnification, which is ×6, written on the eyepiece end. It's attached with a single screw to a bracket on the a plate on the side of the tube. I've read that if you look underneath this plate on some scopes, there is a manufacturer's mark, but not on this one. There's nothing on the bracket, nothing on the tube, no obvious markings that I can see. So I think if there's an expert who can tell me something based on the shape of the bracket itself, well, that might be a clue, but there's nothing that really tells me anything further about the manufacturer. So if we move on to the objective, the G shield is attached just with some felt, and just pulls off. And then I think you can see that this objective lens has got three spacers around the lens. There are no markings I can see, certainly no obvious markings on the the lens cell either on the outside, or if you unscrew the lens cell from the tube, I haven't found any markings on the inside. But again, an expert might be able to tell me if there's something a little bit cryptic that might not be obvious as an identification. Looking inside the tube itself, there are a set of three baffles, and I've read that on some of these scopes, the inside of the tube between the two central baffles, as it were, has not been painted. And in fact, it looks to me, if I have a closer look along this tube, that that's the case for this particular scope. Perhaps just due to manufacturing, it was deemed that it wasn't necessary in order to stop reflections of light, and probably would have been just difficult to reach that part of the tube. Okay, so moving on to the mount. I heard that the tube cradle can be a distinguishing feature, and that there are several similar styles of equatorial on scopes around the same aperture as this one. I'd say that the mount itself is pretty sturdy, it's set in circles. After a bit of lubrication, the slow motions work fine. It's pretty solid. I don't really plan to use the mount at the moment. I'm going to put the scope onto a more modern mount, because really at this sort of focal length, if I'm going to use the scope very much, I know that I really want to be able to track to make it more enjoyable, and it'll get more use. Okay, so this is the case, which is a bit of a beast. This one has foam inserts. I've read that similar scopes, sometimes they're fitted with just wooden dividers within the case. So maybe these foam or styrofoam inserts will help to age or identify this scope. There are no labels I can find on the case. And typically the scope came with a selection of three eyepieces, poro prism, solar screen, etc., etc. But again, none of those items have any obvious clue to their manufacturer. Okay, so some feedback on actually using the scope. So as I mentioned, I've put the tube onto a modern mount. I've got a Vixen Advanced Polaris, so I think the Japanese theme seems to suit. I think it's a good looking arrangement. Pair of 76mm tube rings did the job, easy to find, and the mount's very capable of carrying the scope, because despite the fact that it's over a metre long, it's very lightweight. It's only got a tube weight, it's only 2.6 kilos. So I guess why I like to look at scopes, to admire them, probably like most of us do, the ones you like the most are the ones you use, and the ones from which you get the best views. Certainly that's how I feel about telescopes. So I've used the scope on a few occasions now, and luckily police report that the optics seem very good. So winter skies at the moment, so being able to have a very very clean split of the trapezium, for example, very nicely defined nebulosity in Orion Nebula. A double cluster in this scope is absolutely fantastic. You can just about fit both clusters within the field of view, and lovely colours evident on some of the stars in those two clusters. So a fairly rudimentary star test, didn't really show anything particular, and certainly looking at bright stars, looking at the moon, there isn't any real obvious sign of false colour. So it's early days in terms of using this scope, but fingers crossed, it's a good one. But just to come back to the main purpose of the video, is perhaps for you to help me identify the origins of this particular telescope, particularly how old it is, because I really don't know whether it's 50s, 60s, 70s. So if anybody can perhaps give me a few more clues, I'd like to be able to pin down where it originally came from. Okay. I hope it's been interesting. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.